Greetings from the End Time Apostolic Christian Holiness Church, located at 650 South Warren Avenue in Columbus, Ohio, where Jesus is Lord and our pastor is Bishop Dr. Derek A. Reeves. Due to COVID-19 restrictions, our order of services have changed and are as follows. Sunday school at 9 a.m. Sunday morning worship at 11 a.m. Our weekday services, Tuesday, Bible study at 6 p.m. Wednesday, corporate prayer at 6 p.m. Our services will be available via Zoom and Facebook Live. Let us join in as the Word of God comes forth that is able to heal, save, and deliver.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Just one more time. Lord, I love you.
I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more.
We do bring you greetings in the matchless name of Jesus from End Time Apostolic Christian Holiness Church, where Jesus is Lord and Bishop Dr. Derek Reeves is our senior pastor. The vision of End Time is preparing believers to operate in kingdom principles. The vision that God has given our bishop and to our church, again, is preparing believers to operate in kingdom principles. And to that end, you'll hear a lot of the preaching and teaching directed toward that, at times challenging us to grow, to go higher, challenging us to know what it is that God has called you for. Why? Because we're saved more than just jump and shout. We're saved to do more than just speak in tongues. We're saved to do more than just run around the church. All of it has its place, but we're saved to be change agents. We're saved to be the body of Christ so that we can be interjected into the whole fabric of society so that God moving through us and upon us and in us, where he can utilize us to make a change. So we bring you greetings again from End Time Apostolic Christian Holiness Church. And we're thankful to be before God, and we don't have too much time, so we want to go ahead and get into the Word of God on today. I ask that you will turn with me, please, to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 2, and I will read verses 14 through 19 in your hearing. Again, that is the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 2, verses 14 through 19. This is a very familiar passage of Scripture. Amen. Very familiar passage of Scripture. And the Word of God is penned on this wise. Of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. And their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. Verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated. Today's message will come from, we'll look at the entire chapter holistically to extrapolate all of our points. But the fulcrum, or what we want to focus our attention to, is going to be on verse number 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. And listen, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. The Lord knows those who are his. Corresponding action, let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. This message this morning that we would want to bring to you is a message entitled, The Foundation of God, What Seal Do You Have? The Foundation of God, What Seal Do You Have? Brothers and sisters and saints of God, ladies and gentlemen, as we review this particular book, the Apostle Paul was writing this to his son Timothy in the gospel. Timothy was considered to be the son of Paul in the gospel, and he was left at Ephesus to be a pastor over a church, and some believe over churches. I do ask that you pray with me. I want to try to teach this message today. And if God say the same, some of it may sound like I'm having a tinfoil hat moment, but you bear with me. Bear with me today. Amen. End time, you understand what that means. So bear with me. So Paul was writing this to Timothy because, just to give a backdrop, because Timothy now was left to be a pastor of a church, or some say bishop of churches. So Paul now was trying to illustrate and to dictate how Timothy, as a pastor, should now begin to interact himself and inject himself to be over the church of God. Paul outlined in 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy various things that should happen and how he should handle certain situations and circumstances that would approach the church and that he would find or that he would begin to engage in as a pastor. This particular book, 2 Timothy, was written by Paul, but many believe it was during the time period where now Paul was imprisoned, but it was during the imprisonment where Paul was ready now to be offered up. He was now about to be offered up for the martyrdom, where he has given his life for the cause of Christ. Paul said in 2 Timothy 4 and 7, he said, Timothy, listen, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course and I have kept the faith. Paul said at one point in this book that he was ready now to be offered up as a sacrifice. In other words, Paul went through his entire life and he lived the life for Christ. He went through everything that a believer, if you will, could go through. He saw the mountaintop. He saw the valleys, if you will. Paul at one point said that you cannot tell me anything about persecution. I'm paraphrasing. You can't tell me anything about persecution. He went through his litany. He said, now, number one, I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisee, and I have intellectual prowess. But even in my intellectual prowess, I've learned how to be abased and I've learned how to abound. I've learned how to be rich. I learned how to be without. At one point he said, this many times I was shipwrecked, and this many times I was stoned, and this many times I was beat. In other words, Paul has the ability to inform his believers, glory be to God, that how one should live a life, not just being successful or how we define success on the mountaintop, but how you still can hold on to your faith, hold on to your devotion while being connected to Jesus Christ, even in the midst of persecution. Hallelujah. How is it that one is able to, in the midst of going through situations, being beat and left for dead multiple times? I don't know if we understand the gravity of that statement. I don't know if we understand the gravity of what the apostles and those went through as they penned the scriptures. I said at one point that when we look at the epistles in the Bible, these are not just mere words written by people who were just trying to give theory. These were written by people who not only had theory, but they had application. In other words, the things that they went through and the struggles that they fought against, hallelujah, it allowed them to be able to pen the words, for Christ I live, and to die is gain. Hallelujah. It allowed them to put themselves in a position where it says, come life or death, principality, peril, or sword. Hallelujah. That nothing shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Oh, Lord, help us. Help us to get to the point in this last and evil day that we can be those who are able to say, no matter what circumstance or situation or test or trial, no matter what mental assuasion comes my way, that I'm still able to stand upon the rock of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And still able to say, come principality, power, sword, and though everyone would leave me, Christ Jesus, he stood there right by my side. Glory be to God. Though family leave me, though husband leave me, though wife leave me, though friends forsake me, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I shall and we will be with you even to the end of the age. He said, I shall not leave you comfortless. Glory. Isn't that a blessing that we're able to be comforted by the one who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? He said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will not leave you without a witness. If only if you would just trust me. I'm a high priest that can be touched by all of your infirmities. Oh, come on, let's give God a hand clap praise in the house. And so we see Paul now writing to his son Timothy in the gospel, because Paul understood and he knew the various things that Timothy was going to go through, and more importantly, the things that the church was going to go through. When you look at the whole fulcrum of the book, Paul was writing to Timothy. He gives him exhortations. In chapter 1, he exhorts him to be steadfast in the gospel. I have to give the backdrop so that we can understand why Paul begins to talk about this particular seal, why the foundation of God stands sure, and why the seal of God has these two things. The Lord knows those who are his, and those that name the name of Christ must depart from iniquity. But to get to that point, Paul said, Timothy, you have to be steadfast in the gospel of Jesus Christ. At one point, Paul said, this is the gospel that I preach, that Christ died according to the scripture, was buried and raised according to the scripture. The gospel of Jesus Christ starts with and ends with Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Jesus said, I am the door. Hallelujah. There are not many doors, but Jesus said, I am the door. Why? Because Jesus had to come because of the original sin of Adam. Paul said it on this wise in the book of Romans. He said that by one man, sin entered into the world. That's the man Adam. When Adam sinned and fell, he passed on this genetic defect, this sin nature, to all of his descendants, which were mankind. And so man himself could not get himself away from this component of being separated from God. So God said, prophetically in the book of Psalms, he said, oh, prepare me a body, I will go. He said, sacrifices you would not have. Sacrifices in the Old Testament had their place, but they did not remove, hallelujah, the sin. They just covered them over. Sacrifices in the Old Testament did not pay the price for sin. Why? Because when Adam sinned, he brought man into death and destruction. And the wages of sin is death. And because the man sinned, it had to come through a righteous man to be able to bring about salvation. And so Paul said, this is the gospel, that Jesus died according to the scriptures, that in the Old Testament it prophesied about a Messiah or a Savior that had to come. And this Mashiach that would come would be the one, hallelujah, to deliver mankind. But the Old Testament, Sister Rochelle, what they did was they utilized sacrifices to just cover sin. God said, use a bullock or use a lamb or turtle dove. But the thing about it is these were animals. And so the blood of these animals were not sufficient to truly pay the price for the sin. Oh, glory be to God that Adam committed in the Garden of Eden. And so it needed the blood, hallelujah, of an innocent man. And so the Bible says that the sacrifice is just covered over. And so everyone previous to the cross, when they died, they still did not have access to the throne of God, to the full presence of God, because sin was not fully dealt with. But the Bible says in one portion, that when souls died, they went to a place called paradise. See, before the cross, hell was divided in two different compartments. That's why when Jesus was on the cross, he said, today you shall be with me in paradise. There's a section where those who went, when they died, remember the analogy of Lazarus, or when Jesus began to talk about Lazarus and the poor servant. Lazarus was in a place of torment. Those who died outside of God went to the place of torment. But those who died in the presence of God, hear what I'm saying, in connection with God, they went to what was called paradise. But still, even in paradise, they did not have access to the face of God, to truly be in the presence of God, because there had to be a holding place. Sin, oh glory be to God, sin separated us from God, and the power of sin was so strong that it caused us to be estranged from God. So it caused God himself. Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. And the Bible says in verse 14 of St. John chapter 1, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. He tabernacled among us. God came in flesh. Why? Jesus said, I've come to destroy the works of the devil. And so the gospel is that Jesus came in the flesh. Why? To destroy the works of the devil that was initiated, hallelujah, in the book of Genesis in the garden. That where Adam sinned and left God, Jesus now, through the obedience of death, he knew no sin, but became like sinful flesh. No, glory be to God, not sinning, but became like sinful flesh, so that he could take our sin upon him. And so he took our sin, and when he died, went to the lowest parts of the earth. Who is this that ascended, but the same that also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? Hallelujah. So that he, when he raised far above all things. And so the gospel is that Jesus died according to the scripture, breaking, hallelujah, the power of sin and destroying the works of the devil. But he didn't just stay in the grave. The Bible says he raised. And when he raised with all power, authority, and glory. And as a result, the Bible says that I will not leave you comfortless, but I will endue you with power from on high. So the gospel is that Jesus died for you and I's sin. And as a result, that we then can obey the gospel through repentance and being baptized
in his name. And when we receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, he then transforms our nature, and now we're connected to God to walk in this power, to walk in this new life, that we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we also should walk in this newness of life. He gives newness of life. He gives freshness of life. Qualitatively new. Behold, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away and all things have become new. Jesus and the gospel indicates that he died for our sins, and that when we're linked to him through baptism in his name, filled with his spirit, that now we have the ability to, oh glory be to God, to walk in this power where he destroyed the power of sin. He destroyed the power that sin had over our lives, that we no longer had to be servants of sin. We no longer had to be servitude to the things that's connected to the enemy. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Glory be to God. That's a time for a praise break right then and there. Just to think that he's moved me to a position where I don't have to be subject to my nature, my old nature. I don't have to be subject to how I was born. I don't have to be subject to my environment. I don't have to be subject to the neighborhood I grew up in. But when I'm in Christ and I have his spirit and power, he's able to renew me, able to strengthen me, able to empower me, so I don't have to be subject to who you say I am. I just have to realize that I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ that lives in me. And this life that I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Give God some praise in the house. Oh, come on, Facebook, give God some praise. Come on, house of God, give God some praise. Come on, let me see the hands. Let me see something. Let me know that you're listening with us, because he's worthy. God is worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so Paul tries to instruct Timothy, stay steadfast in this gospel, that there is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. There's one God and Father of all, who is in you all and through you all. Don't let anyone distort the truth of this gospel, that we have to be buried with him by baptism in his name, and that we have to be filled with this spirit, and it causes a change of life. Hallelujah. It causes the change of life. It causes us to change our life. Bishop Dr. Reeves wrote a book called Life Force, and he spoke of different life and different terms for life in the scripture. And the Bible says that the life of God, or the very spirit of God, when it's introduced to us, it has two major applications. It has a moral application and an essential application. The essential application is when we receive the life or the spirit of God in us. The Bible says, and ye shall have power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. When the Holy Ghost is in you and I, he infuses us with power. Power that comes as a result of our nature. Power that allows us to function as our God functions. Power to be able to do the things that Christ has done. Power to be the body of Christ. Power, dunamis, explosive, supernatural power is essential. But then there is the moral component that comes. Hallelujah. There is an anointing that's in us. And then what it does is it changes changes our heart. He circumcises our heart. Glory be to God. He cuts away the old man of the heart, where I used to want to hate. Now he pricks me and causes me to love. Where I wanted to walk estranged from him, now he pushes me closer to him. Oh, glory be to God. Just as it says in Proverbs, I no longer want to do the things that the Lord hates. I no longer want to backbite. I no longer want to shed innocent blood. I no longer want to walk pridefully. I no longer want to run quickly to cause mischief. Glory be to God. Yes. Yes, yes. This moral life is more than just not drinking and not smoking and whoremongering. Yes, that's a part of it. But hallelujah, it's a complete package, baby. Hallelujah, he moves upon me so that I can love right, forgive right, extend my hand right. Oh, glory be to God. We like to capitalize on the things that we can see. Glory, but we don't want to capitalize on the changed heart. But when we're in Christ, that essential life and that moral life causes me to live like him, to reflect him in everything I do. The Bible says that this partition has been moved, and that I can behold the glory of God, that he removed the very thing that kept me separated. And as I behold his glory, I'm transformed more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. I begin to reflect him in my thoughts. I reflect him in my conversation. I reflect him in the things I love to do. I reflect him in my heart's desires. I reflect him in my inclinations, in my propensities. I go beyond WWJD, what would Jesus do? And now I say, now I'm going to live and do what Jesus is doing, because I am now the body of Christ. I am now the Word made flesh, because if Jesus lives in you, you have the Word of God in you, and he expects us to live out his word. Glory be to God in an everyday life fashion. Give God some praise in the house. Hallelujah. Let me slow down. And so Paul, then he exhorts Timothy, be steadfast in the gospel. He exhorts him to be patient while you are enduring suffering. Do you hear what I said? He exhorts him to be patient while you are enduring suffering. He exhorts him to be faithful as a leader. And then when you go to chapter 3 and you begin to look at it, he begins to warn against things that are going to happen during the last of the last days, how there will be perilous times. And he talked about duties that he should enact and live, and how he should live in perilous times. And so, brothers and sisters, if you have not noticed and if you have not seen, we are in the position where the Bible calls the last of the last days. And so how do we indicate that, or why do we say that? Brothers and sisters, if you recall, the Bible talks about the time period where Jesus spoke of in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and various other prophets in the Old Testament spoke of this time. But they said that specific things could not happen until the Jewish people became a nation again. There's specific prophetic utterances that could not take place until the Jewish people became a nation. And around 1948, around that time period, when they became a nation, that was the starting clock to begin to look at world events, to begin to see and outline how this world is being constructed and moved to the final place, the final time period, the final kingdom that spoke of by Daniel, the last 10 toes. Final kingdom that's spoken of in the book of Revelation, the kingdom in which, or the world system in which, the man of sin, the man of perdition, will come to the forefront. And they describe a specific system that would be in place, a global system that will be connected together globally, and it will be so interconnected and so intertwined that it will enable the system of the Antichrist or the man of sin to come forth. What? system that is combined economically, a system that's combined technologically, a system that's combined through education, and a system that's combined religiously. Oh, and so when we look at this, brothers and sisters, it is in this light that Paul is writing to Timothy. He's trying to exhort him and trying to instruct him and trying to bring him to the place of understanding of what kind of mindset should he have during this particular time, and how should he equip himself to be ready and prepared to war and to fight and to be those who God has called him to be. And so when you look at chapter number 2, this brings us into context. Chapter number 2, Paul then tells Timothy, look at what he says, brothers and sisters. He says that he, verse number 2, and the things which you heard of me, he said, teach them. But verse number 3, he says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chose him to be a soldier. And so, brothers and sisters, he says first, you have to understand that you and I will go through hardness. There will be hardness in this life. There will be hardships in this life. And more particularly, he's talking about, you and I will go through hardships because of the stance that we're taking as it relates to the Bible and Jesus himself. That when you stand, as Paul said, he was going through for the gospel's sake. He was being attacked for the gospel's sake. And so, when you say there's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, and there's only one way to God through Jesus, he said, be prepared to go through hardness. Be prepared to endure hardness as a good soldier. And the only way we can do this, brothers and sisters, one way I should say, is that we have to understand that we are a soldier and we're warring. And because we are in this war, because we are in this spiritual warfare, I should not entangle myself with the affairs of this life. Oh, hear me what I'm saying. I'm not saying that you don't love your family, brothers and sisters. I'm not saying that you don't take care of business. I am not saying that you don't work and go to your job. Because the only way we can be a change agent, glory be to God, we have to be able to interject ourselves into this system, but living correctly. But what he says is we don't entangle ourselves with the affairs of this life. In other words, I do not adopt the philosophical principles that dictate this world. Hallelujah. I don't adapt my mind and my heart or concern myself trying to please people that's connected in this world. Glory be to God. I'm concerned with just pleasing him who have called me to be a soldier. Oh, glory. Are you with me, please? I'm here to please him that have enlisted me. I'm to wear this world as a loose garment. In other words, I'm in the world, but I'm not a part of it. I realize I'm in this world, glory be to God, but because of who I am and whose I am, there necessitates a differentiation between who I am and those that I'm connected to. Oh, yes, there can be Josephs in the midst of Pharaohs. There can be Daniels in the midst of Nebuchadnezzar and Darius. There can be Hananiah, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the council of the king. Those who stood up for their God, who did not change their adherence to who he is, but yet and still being effective where God has moved them. So Paul says, listen, you can't entangle yourself in this world. You have to endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Because when you war, you don't entangle yourself with the affairs of this world. Hallelujah. Because In doing so, I must understand that when I strive, I have to strive for mastery. The Bible says, and if a man strive for masteries, yet he's not crowned unless he strive lawfully. In other words, brothers and sisters, this term strive refers to the Olympic Games or going in competition. The only way that I can be crowned a winner, I must strive lawfully. I must follow the laws that's connected with the games in which I'm connected to. And then he follows up by saying the husband that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits. In other words, it says in its translation, before I could become a partaker of the fruits, I must first labor and do the things that are necessary first, hallelujah, so that I can get the fruits. And so Paul is building his case to Timothy. He's trying to outline that you are a soldier and you have to connect yourself as a soldier. Being a soldier of Jesus Christ, you have to realize that you strive lawfully, that there are rules and regulations that's connected to the kingdom of God, that you cannot say that you belong to him and do your own thing. He even goes as far as to outline those who gave false teachings. He goes and outlines those who gave false teaching and caused people to err and to remove themselves from the truth. Hallelujah. But Paul says unto Timothy, he says, listen, brother, you're going to go through and there are things you're going to fight with, but you must follow the laws that's connected to the kingdom of God in order to receive the proper crown, in order to move yourself in the proper position. You must be able to strive lawfully. You must be able to strive lawfully. Keep that in your mind. You must be able to strive lawfully. Hallelujah. And so then he moves to the place where he says in verse 19, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure. The foundation of God standeth sure. He affirms that there is the foundation. God, Jesus, is the foundation. The Bible calls him the chief cornerstone. He says, no matter what may happen, and you're going to move to a place where you're going to see a lot of people apostatizing and leaving the truth, people who are going to say you can do anything and still be saved. There are going to be people who are going to say that you can live any old kind of way and still name the name of Christ. But Paul says, don't worry. The foundation of God always stands sure. No matter who may apostatize, and no matter whether I follow it or not, Jesus as the chief cornerstone, it stands sure. It's immovable. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he is the great mighty potentate. He is the great God from glory. He is the one that we put our faith in. This foundation, he says, stands sure. Hallelujah. And because he is the foundation, the Bible says that not only is he the foundation, but 1 Peter indicates, he says, 1 Peter 2 and 5, ye are also as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Oh, glory be to God. So Jesus is the foundation. But those who now are born again in his name and receive his spirit, the Bible says we are now lively stones built up to make the spiritual house of God. We now are the body of Jesus Christ. And so the foundation of God, it stands sure, but it has this seal. The seal that was a part of the foundation, when the seal was on something, it gave the indication of what was inside. The seal showed the characteristics of what should be inside of the building. Are you following me? And so he says, the foundation of God standeth sure, but there is a seal. There is a mark that comes upon those that's connected to the foundation, and there are characteristics that show what should be inside the building. Glory be to God. There's two major indications. I got to run across this field. There are two major indications that are given. Number one, the Bible says the Lord knoweth those who are his. No matter what happens and no matter who tries to perpetrate, no matter who tries to grow up as tares among the wheat, the Lord knoweth those who are his. It's an intimate knowing. It's not a superficial knowing, but he intimately knows those who are his. And he not only knows those who are his, but there's an indication that those who are his know him. Because one of the definitions gives a Jewish idiom of how a man would know a woman sexually. And so there is a sign of intimacy of one knowing each other. So the Lord knows those who are his. That's the first seal. And the second is, let all those that name the name of Christ, those who name, who call upon the name, those who profess the name, and those who have the name ascribed to them, those who name the name of Christ must depart from iniquity. Why is departing from iniquity so important? Let me teach for about 2 or 3 minutes and then we'll go ahead and go home. Departing from iniquity is so important because when you look at iniquity, iniquity seems to be the very thing that inspired Lucifer and was found in Lucifer, and it seems to be the very thing that promulgates his kingdom. The Bible says in Ezekiel 28 that he was the anointed cherub that covered, and that it was to be so. He was upon the holy mountain of God and walked up and down the midst of the stones of fire. The Bible says he was perfect in all of his ways and until iniquity was found in him. So iniquity then was placed or was found in Lucifer, and this iniquity then seems to be the very thing that pervades his kingdom. He was the anointed cherub. Yes, Satan or Lucifer has an anointing. Hallelujah. He has a power that works with him and through him. And when he sinned and iniquity was found in him, he distorted this anointing and it became infused with the same iniquity power, if you will, and then began to permeate his kingdom. And so iniquity then, iniquity is defined as perverseness or wickedness. It refers to one who moves into moral wrongness, where you have unrighteousness in your heart. And so as it pertains to the scripture, iniquity is where one is violating the laws, the righteousness and morality as ordained by God. That's why I said earlier, hallelujah, that we have to, those that run this race must do so lawfully. Why? According to God's standards, according to God's measures, and according to the word of God. What does the word say about it? Does the word agree with it, or does it disagree with it? And so iniquity is so important because it's the very thing that infused itself through Lucifer and it seemed to move through his kingdom. Real quickly, when we look at sin, transgression, and iniquity, I think it helps to understand the categorizations and how it's broken down. So again, we can understand the power that's in iniquity. Sin means to miss the mark, and it's a general term for falling short of God's standard. Romans 3, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So when we sin, we speak of one missing the mark of God. Sins can be intentional and it can be unintentional. However, it just means that we have fallen short, that we miss the mark. You follow me so far? Glory be to God. The next thing is transgression. Transgression means where one intentionally moves to disobey or to willfully trespass a command. You follow me? Sin, you miss the mark. We're born in sin. We're born missing the mark. But then transgression means that now I begin to understand what to do and what not to do, but now I am willfully disobeying. You follow me so far? David said, He said, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Again, transgression is connected to a trespass, which is willful violation of the law. You follow me so far? And then number three, iniquity. Iniquity is a perversion of the truth, and it is twisted, is a twisted attitude that permeates and makes plans to commit sin. Iniquities. It becomes a second nature and second nature tendencies that drives one to repeatedly commit sin and defile their character. So what happens is when you move to iniquity, iniquity now where is where now you have fixed yourself that you know the truth, you see the truth, and you know what the truth of God says, but you're purposely distorting the truth. You're changing and manipulating the truth. So that you then can do those things that are opposed to God, and you give excuses as to why you are doing them. Glory be to God. Don't we see this in the garden? Satan utilized this. He told Eve, thou shalt not surely die. Hallelujah. But if you take of the fruit, God knows that you'll be like God. He distorted the truth. The iniquity began to push it. And so the reason why understanding iniquity is so important. As we said, it's the very thing that pushes his kingdom. It's the very thing that ingratiates itself in his kingdom. And speaking of iniquity, the Bible says, glory be to God, speaking of the man of sin in 2 Thessalonians, and I have to wrap it up, but speaking of the man of sin, it said in 2 Thessalonians, chapter, I don't have the chapter, but just you'll find it on your own, or just text me and I'll give it to you. But in 2 Thessalonians, he says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. Now listen what he says. And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Hallelujah. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. The Bible talks about the mystery of iniquity that was already working and in place. Hallelujah. It's going to come forth as a fulcrum in the man of perdition, or what we call the Antichrist, or however you want to name him, the man of sin. But the Bible says it comes to the fulcrum when he comes. But there is a mystery of iniquity that was already in place. In other words, even though you could see it, but he still works in the shadows. He still works subversively. Hallelujah. And this mystery still was permeating what? To ingratiate itself and inculcate itself amongst the worldly system to make sure that the world system is moved to be opposed to the truth of God. That's why in this world system, we see that everything that's being promoted is that which is against God. It's against who God is and against who, glory be to God, against his word, the absoluteness of his word. It was hidden. This is where many, what's called many mystery religions come from. Those mystery occult religions. Why? Because they say we work in iniquity through mystery, through subversiveness, but we integrate ourselves through the world system to promote, hallelujah, the very outcomes that we desire. I have to run across this field. That's where we see, brothers and sisters, the many things, the construction of the world systems, whether it be, as we said, the United Nations or the World Banks, when we see the educational systems, those individuals like Alice Bailey and Helena Blavatsky, part of Lucis Trust, they all had the hand in developing things that are now connected to the world system, trying to connect us globally so that we can can have a global religion, a global mindset, and all of these things to bring about a global bank and a global society. I don't have time to go through it, but yes, please look up the UN Agenda 2030 Global Sustainability. Let us not forget what Manly P. Hall said and Helena Blavatsky said. These individuals that had direct influence, hallelujah, in the construction of and the connection of the worldly systems. They say that they're trying to get the seething powers of Lucifer, hallelujah, the seething powers of Lucifer to be released in his energies, to be released amongst all that are connected. They believe that Lucifer is the light. Glory. And so that's why it's so important, brothers and sisters, to understand why he says, let all those that name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Because iniquity is directly connected to the force of Satan. And what he does is he tries to cause the mind and hearts of people to move away from the kingdom of God. He tries to establish things that directly oppose the word of God. Think it not strange, brothers and sisters, that the philosophies now of this world is directly opposing an absolute standard of the scriptures. Think it not strange, brothers and sisters, that when you stand up for the truth of the word of God, that you will be ostracized and castigated. Think it not strange, brothers and sisters, that when you stand for the truth and you say, for God I live and for God I die, and one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, that there must be a change of life that you and I will not go through. The foundation of God, and what seal do you have? There is a foundation, and Jesus Christ is the foundation. He is the one in which we are to build our purposes. He is the one that we are to build our building on. Jesus said, if you try to build your house on anything else, if the foundation is not sure, when the rain and wind comes, it will cause the house to be soon fall away. But when you build your house on a sure foundation, and that foundation is Christ, when you build your house on who Jesus is, when you build your foundation on Jesus being Lord and Savior, when you build your foundation that he died and that he rose again, when you build your foundation on these two things, hallelujah, this seal of God, the seal of God is placed upon us, for the foundation of God is sure, is steadfast, it's unmovable. The foundation of God is one that's fixed, cannot be moved. Jesus Christ, he is the chief cornerstone. When I build my foundation on Jesus Christ, I realize that I have to have this seal. I need to know him, and he knows me. What seal do you have? Does God know you? Does he have a relationship with you? Does he know you after the power of his resurrection? Does he know who you are? Does he know your name? Does he know your mind? Does he have your love? The foundation of God stands sure, and it has this seal. What seal do you have? I don't care, brother, if you know me. I don't care, sister, if you know me. I only care if I'm known by Jesus. I need to know him. I need to love him. I need to be connected to him. I need to know him after the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. I need to know the Lord, and I want to be known by him. And then number two, let everyone that names the name of Christ, if you have his name, if you call upon his name, after closer you move in relationship with him. Listen, it may not start that way. Hallelujah, but there's corresponding actions that comes as a result of knowing him. Let foes that name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Hallelujah. I need to lay aside every sin and the ways and the sin that doth so easily beset me. This is the seal of God. I know him. He knows me. But now that I name his name, now that I'm connected to his name, I depart from iniquity. Remove yourself from trying to do your own thing. Remove yourself from trying to make excuses as to why you can't live right. Remove yourself by saying it's too hard. Remove yourself from saying that I can do it. Don't let the devil lie to you. As the old folk used to say, the devil is a lie and the truth is not in him. Don't distort the word of God to continue to live a life that's not connected to the word of God. Let those that name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. We are the body of Christ. When you receive his spirit, baptize in his name, I now am the body of Christ. I now am the anointed of Christ. And as he lives, I live also. I can move in the same power, seated with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I have the authority to overcome the works of the enemy. I can mortify the deeds of my body. There must be a change when I'm in Christ. There must be a difference when I'm in Christ. I may stumble, I may fall, but I don't stay there. I don't stay in my muck and mire, because I realize he knows me. And when I'm connected to him, he said he doesn't desire that anyone should perish. And if I be in Christ, I'm a new creature. Yes, the devil may swing. Yes, I may get caught. Yes, I may get knocked back. But I'm not over. I'm not out. When I'm connected to him, he brings me to the place where I can say, like Paul said, come life, come death, come principality, come peril, come sword. I can't be separated from his love. That's my confession. Yes, I may go through, but the Bible says that if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. I may fail, but let me reach and connect myself with my advocate. He said, I can come to the throne, lay before him, inquire grace and mercy in the time of need. What foundation are we on? What seal do you have? And when you have the Holy Ghost, the Bible says that we're sealed until the day of redemption. As long as you have his spirit, honey, keep fighting. As long as you have his spirit, keep praising. As long as you have his spirit, keep repenting. Get before your God and let him strengthen you. Oh, this is the seal of God. The Lord knows those who are his. And because I name the name of Christ, he empowers me to depart from iniquity, empowers me to have a change. He empowers me to be able to live this life. Give God some praise in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The foundation of God. The foundation of God. What seal do you have? Remember, the seal talked about the characteristics that were in the building, the characteristics that were part of the building. And the characteristics then, the major characteristics that we display and we show, the Bible says, having this seal, number one, the Lord knows those who are his. And number two, let all those that name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. We have to depart and remove ourselves from iniquity because the Bible says, and I didn't get a chance to really say it appropriately, the Bible says that we should lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us. See, when we don't deal with the weight and the sin is what keeps us, keep it open so that we can move to iniquity. You understand what I'm saying? If we don't deal with the weight and the sin, every one of us has whatever the sin is. And that sin, if we don't deal with it, that missing the mark, if we don't deal with it, what it does is it allows that door to stay open and eventually we'll give an excuse as to why it's okay to do those particular things and we move over to iniquity. Iniquity is the very force that seems to empower the kingdom of God. And as we said, when you look through this world, we see that the whole world structure is literally moving and have moved to the place where now the enemy has allowed to where you can see the emergence of the Antichrist is soon to come. If you haven't seen it, brothers and sisters, and have not known, we've talked about it. You can just see, and I hate to keep sounding like a broken record, but what they call the signs of the times. We see the increase of not just earthquakes and all these particular things, but now we see volcanoes consistently going off in various areas. And it seems like it's not just centralized in one place, but more on a global scale. We see those things happening. We see the convergence of technology. Have you not seen it, brothers and sisters? Have you not seen it where the news source are already saying that China has already begun to create a super soldier? That stuff you see in Captain America and all that other stuff, they already are on it. And you better believe if they allow us to see it or read about it, they are more advanced than what we can think. Have you not seen from a technology standpoint where because of the pandemic, how it's pushed us with during the World Economic Forum, they call it the fourth industrial revolution, where it means that now we move to where we're moving from the technology, but now it's moved where technology now is being integrated with us. So now it's moved from just technology, but now it's integrated biologically, where now we're moving to the next fulcrum. If you haven't seen, they're talking about brain implant chips. They show a monkey with this Neuralink network brain implant chips where he's moving things with his mind. Oh, glory be to God. If you don't understand what I just said, then Lord have mercy.
The End Time Apostolic Christian Holiness Church would like to thank you for listening to the Anointed Word of God. For a copy of this message or to receive information about the Apostolic Christian Holiness Ministry, contact us at 614-274-8217 or write to us at 650 South Warren Avenue, Columbus, Ohio 43204, or you can visit us on our web at www.in-time.org. We are conveniently located off of I-70 West, exit 98A, just 5 minutes west of downtown. Thank you for listening. And until next time, may God bless you and keep you.